What's up, ladies and gentlemen of YouTube, Boogie to 988, coming at you live once again through the power of the Big Stack Podcast. You are listening to the Big Stack Podcast, episode number, oh God, I forgot, four.
Episode number five.
Is this number five? Because we have three episodes now available on the iTunes, right? How many is on available on iTunes?
Four.
And they're all four available on iTunes.
They should all be available on iTunes.
If a lot of people have been asking to hear it on Spotify, we are available on Spotify as well. Don't forget we're available on the SoundCloud. And if you want easy access to all of this stuff, you can check out our Patreon at patreon.com/thebigstackpodcast. Also, glad to say we now have a vanity URL at YouTube. And you can find us at youtube.com/C. I don't know, what's the C stand for? The Big Stack Podcast, joined as usual with Jacob and Ellis, and this week is our very first guest, the one, the only, professor from Tolarian Community College. Though I think we'll refer to him as the professor. We can be
on first name basis here. You can just call me the.
All right. And if you're unfamiliar with the Tolarian Community College channel, it is the largest, absolute largest Magic the Gathering channel out there. It puts the official Magic the Gathering channel to shame by 100,000 subscribers or so or more. Dude averages like 35, 55, 65,000 views per upload dedicated towards Magic the Gathering and products. Well, you describe your channel, Prof. What do you say about your own channel?
Well, I think you covered it. We are all things. I don't know why I'm saying we. It literally is just me. But I'm all things Magic the Gathering, and I'm best known for product reviews. So if you still are old-fashioned and play with paper Magic cards as opposed to those newfangled e-cards, digital cards on Arena, then you probably want things like card sleeves or deck boxes. And basically, if it's for sale at your local game store, I have bought it and tested it and filmed a review with it. And so you can save your money and watch me show off the product from different angles, do some stress tests on it, tell you about it. I usually play with it for about 2 months before doing the video, give or take. And so I give a grade, but of course the thing is just really what works for you as a player. And that's what I'm best known for, is the product reviews, but I also have deck decks and sometimes comedy skits and other things like that on the channel. But
I do like the comedy sketches. And whenever you do your card reveals, they're always goofy and silly and like sometimes cringy, right? Like I think the episode I was in, I cringed when I watched it, but it's good.
I'm afraid that I am of that old-fashioned comedy type where I do enjoy that just intentional cringy.
It's so good.
So a lot of people are like, oh, you made it cringy, and I'm like, thank you.
And I do know you.
I was going for that because I think that's funny.
You dabbled with other card games a little bit. Like, obviously, you've talked about Pokemon quite a bit. You talked about the
Pokemon
Binding of Isaac board game. You talked a little bit about. You made an episode about. What's the game with the strands? The other Richard Garfield game recently. What's it called again?
Keyforge,
right. Yeah, you made a tutorial to Keyforge. So it's not exclusively Magic content, but I do know how you feel about Hearthstone.
Oh, God. Well, I'm, you know, Hearthstone just isn't for me, but that's just because I like, you know, card games.
Biting criticism. So here's something that when me and the professor did a tournament using funding by the folks over the Wizards Coast, we raised about $10,000 for St. Jude. And he flew in to guest appear at that event, and we hung out for a little while. And while he was here, I made him play Hearthstone and recorded it, and I have never released that to the world because of how much he hated it.
Listen, I don't want to yuck anyone's yum. If you like Hearthstone, that's great, but oh boy, is it not for me.
It is a really casual card game. Like, that's the thing, and that's what I was originally drawn to it. But when they would do weird stuff with Hearthstone, you remember the old Magic the Gathering Microprose game, right?
Yeah, that one was excellent, but I remember anything by Microprose was great. Master of Orion, anyone?
Oh, they also made Master of Magic, right? Like that was like
they did a Master of Magic. I think they did like a Birth of the Federation Star Trek game too. I miss Microprose.
But they had a lot of random effects. They had a subset of celestial cards, I think is what they called them. And they're like the Aswan Jaguar, which had like random effects and random this. Something you could only do in a digital CCG, right? And so that's what Hearthstone started to do. They did a lot of those cool effects. And then they did them in such annoying ways, like with Jabberwocky and
Shutterwalk.
Yeah, just such annoying bad examples. Like eventually, that just it got too far into that direction, and it was not close enough to an actual card game. Ellis, how you doing this week, man? Playing any video games?
I'm doing good. Yeah, I'm mostly been playing MTG Arena.
Oh yeah, been playing a lot of Arena, man. I've actually started playing Standard Arena. What are you playing in? What are you playing on Arena? Are you drafting or are you sealed?
I do a lot of drafts because it's hard for me to make myself go down to my LGS recently. But I get to draft at home in my pajamas, and that's great. I have a blast doing that. But I'm playing some Standard. I'm having a hard time not building gate mana bases for just all of my decks, every single one of them. I absolutely love Gates of Blaze. That card is incredible.
That card is really good.
I like this limited format. It's a lot more evenly spread than the last Ravnica set was. Last one we had mostly just sort of like Boros, Dimir, and then everybody else was way down here. And that was particularly slanted on MTG Arena because you're drafting against bots. So when you're at a table of actual humans, if everybody knows Boros is the best deck and everybody tries to cannibalize it, nobody's going to have a good Boros deck. It doesn't really work out that way on Arena, and that's kind of a shame. And it's a lot more confusing drafting against a bot. It's harder to read signals and understand sort of like what's going on.
Yeah, Rakdos is a lot. I built a constructed Rakdos deck using the juggler, the ones that's like juggling skulls, allows you to draw a card, discard a card, draw a card. And then if you pay her spectacle cost, you can discard your hand and draw three cards. And then like there's like a hidden third mode that I didn't realize till the first time I played it with an empty hand. But if you play her as your only card, you just draw a card because you can't discard anything.
Sure.
And it doesn't say if you don't discard a card, draw a card. And so you run that and then the three casting cost 3/2 dude that says when something dies, draw a card and lose a life. And you're drawing so many cards and then light the stage. Is that the one red instance, like spectacle cost one red, exile two cards?
I love that card so much.
Absurd, man. It's my favorite card in
that's what
standard
red
right now.
Should be doing. I will warn you, for those of you who are used to this podcast, we are going to talk about Anthem. I promise you, we will talk about Anthem and we will timestamp when we talk about Anthem. But as all Magic the Gathering players in this room right now who've been playing, I've been playing this game for 25 years to Prof. How long have you been playing, Prof?
Probably about 23.
Yeah, and then.
But I mean, I took a giant hiatus in the middle to go to grad school and travel the world and other worthless things. But then I came back to playing cards indoors. So, you know.
I took a 7-year gap between the Urza block and the first Ravnica. The first Ravnica is what brought me in. So I have a special place in my heart for Ravnica.
First Ravnica was amazing.
We will talk a lot about Magic the Gathering this episode. So you may want to pay special close attention to the timestamps if you're on YouTube. I promise you we will talk about Anthem. Jacob, you've been playing Magic for a decade that I know of, right?
Fifth Dawn was the first set that I played in.
And Ellis, you've been playing since
35 years, actually. No stops.
What?
No
the game, what?
You started 10 years before Richard Garfield invented the game.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Well, time travel allows you to do that.
That's real commitment, okay?
Yeah. Time travel lets you do stuff like that.
What was my first set? I'm trying to remember. Probably, I played an Onslaught, but I was a very, very young kid, and I didn't really know what I was doing. I just was like, cool dragons! And so that was my experience with Magic, but cool dragons was enough to get me into it. That kind of art style keeps me coming back to Magic.
So here's a cool question for you. Okay, so here's what got me into Magic. I'd heard, I bought a copy of Troll and Toad's catalog / magazine. Got shipped in the mail because we ordered like a D&D book from them. And they had a little article about Magic the Gathering in it. And this was, at the time, Antiquities was the latest set. Yes, Magic the Gathering players tell time by Magic sets. What year was that? Oh, that was 94. That's when Antiquities came out. Oh,
right.
That's right. But Antiquities is the current set. Arabian Nights had mostly sold out. And we were just about, we had some unlimited in stores. And I flipped through this magazine and it had a picture of Blood Moon scanned in, or Bad Moon. You know, all black creatures get +1/+1.
Oh, Bad Moon. Okay.
And it had like a picture of skeleton, Drudge Skeletons. And I look at the two cards and I'm like, well, if you had both these cards out, then that Drudge Skeleton would be a 2/2. I don't know what that means, but wow, this art is cool and the idea behind this is cool. And I went down to the only gaming store within a 35-mile radius. And they had an unlimited starter deck that they called the store deck. And you could trade cards out of it one for one. So if there was a time walk in there, someone could put a swamp in there, and but I paid $10 for that. And I still got a bunch of unlimited lands and cool shit out of it, right? And then I bought like two packs of antiquities, and I thought, this is all I'll ever buy. This is like $15 of the magic cards. That's a lot. Came back down with my stipend from the university, like my mom's like allowance. I came back in about $100 of the magic cards the next time I came in. Now I spend like $1,000 every new set because I'm an idiot. Yeah.
I used to literally skip lunch to use my lunch money to buy magic cards, and I'd be starving after school because I would have breakfast, and then it would be at 3 o'clock, right? And get home at 3:15, 3:20. And I'm just like, I need food, but I have money every day for, you know, every 2 days. That's another pack.
You skip lunch. That's a booster, right? What brought you into the game, Prof? Like, what's your origin story?
This girl, she played magic. Like, I mean, I know that's very typical. Most guys get into Magic the Gathering to meet girls. But
very common.
Listen, that's how I got my first girlfriend. And we may not have lasted, but my love of magic did. But yeah, it was just basically a ploy to have a reason to be around this girl. She played. There was like this little, it was kind of cool. Our high school had this area that the nerds had taken over. And we just claimed it for D&D players and magic players. And do you remember there was like a game called Jihad? Mm-hmm. And what was it? It was like Vampire the Legacy.
Vampire the Masquerade.
Mm-hmm. And then there was like a Star Trek The Next Generation trading card game. And there was maybe about, I think, total like, I don't know, it was a while ago, but like 17 to 20 of us. And we had just claimed this cool little like area with some cement benches around like a little flower garden thing, and this was for the nerds. And we'd walk around and be like, anyone want to get a game of X? Anyone looking to get a thing? The D&D players be running a little quick campaign at lunch. And I just, you know, it was like she played magic, and I was just like, oh cool, you know, maybe you could teach me. And I got hooked on the game. I liked it a lot, and I sold all my cards when I graduated high school, my original dual lands for $10 each, because as I figured at the time, grown-ups don't play magic. I've kept them in card sleeves even then, in little penny sleeves, and they were in perfect condition. And I was like, I can get $10 each for this volcanic island and these I get like 3 underground seas. That's $30. I'm not going to play with cards as a grown-up.
And an underground –
serious things in college, like liberal arts.
An unlimited, for those of you who are unaware, an unlimited underground sea's worth like 300 right now with the crash. Like it's 280, 300 in that neighborhood, right?
Sounds about right.
Yeah, so he gave away a lot.
What a good deal.
I did the same thing. I sold all of my magic cards back in 2001 because I ended up getting sick and I was done traveling and I was done trying to get on the pro tour, and I knew I was never good enough to get on the pro tour. So like, what's the point in playing anyway? If I can't get on the pro tour, what's the point? I want to be a millionaire. And I sold like my Black Lotus and my Moxes, my Time Walk, my Time Twister, Sister Recall, my Guardian Beasts, my Dual Lands. Dual Lands went for like 20 a pop. The Moxes went for like 200 a pop. The Lotus went for like 300. And just, I don't know why. My friend Ricky came over and he's like, what about all these antiquity cards? I'm like, I don't care. He's like, well, you got like 5 candelabras of Taunus. I'm like, yeah, I don't know, $20 a pop. That's fine. What about these 3 Mishra's workshops? I don't know, man, like $50 or $20, whatever. I don't care. I just want rid of it. I just want cash in my pocket. What a stupid decision. What about you, Jacob? What brought you into that game?
I had a best friend who played Magic, and we just went to the shop every day. I did the skip in my lunch thing, except I just saved all of that money till the end of the week. And then I did a draft at the end of the week.
Nice.
I remember the first, we did like a 8th edition draft. I think, I can't remember. I just know this because Wrath of God was in the set, and I opened my pack. All right. And I love goblins. I will always gravitate towards red cards, especially if they're goblins. And there was a red goblin card or a foil Wrath of God. And I first picked this goblin and passed it to the guy next to me. And he looked at me and said, hey man, are you sure about this? And I was like, yeah, have you read this goblin? He's great. And he's like, all right, man, as long as you're happy, I just want to make sure you're happy. And I was happy. And I lost that draft, but I had my goblin card. So it's fine.
And Ellis,
I'm so glad you were happy.
Ellis, I think I remember you walking into the magic shop, but what got you into the game?
My dad took me to some, I don't know, like nerd shop that his buddy owned that was above a sushi joint we were going to. And I was just sort of like wandering around the store while he and his friend caught up. And I found a box of, it was a starter deck for Portal. So those are the oldest cards that I owned. And oh, nice. I believe I sold them all for probably about 10 bucks. It cost 10 bucks to buy the thing. So I sold it for $10 and I got a great deal there.
Oh, yeah.
Because those cards are not worth anything.
It's not like it was Third Kingdom or anything, right? You know?
No. It wasn't Portal Three Kingdoms. It was just Portal. Back when they had the weird like symbols next to the power and toughness.
Oh yeah, that's so weird.
The sword and the shield and stuff. Yeah.
Portal was supposed to be like their way of teaching new players to play the game, and why? Because I don't know. Like, you know how I learned to play the game was from the basic set from Unlimited, right? Just why? Why don't I understand?
They made it more complicated too. Like they ended up overthinking it, and so they're like, well, like there you go, the sword and the shield, and they're like, oh, okay, so you got two numbers here, and so we got to make it so that players know which one's the attack and the defense. We'll add a little symbol. You see a sword, you know that's attack. You see a shield, you know that's defense. But then the whole, it's just they did that to every teeny little square centimeter of the card, and it just ended up being like, oh my goodness, you can't parse this anymore.
Yeah, one of the,
I had a hard time understanding it. My young brain
more understandable.
One of the many failed attempts to bring new players into the game when the game sells itself. Like you don't need to. I mean, it's nice that they have some.
The arena's bringing in a lot of new players.
Oh yeah, yeah. So I played in a pre-release recently. And I was asking people, like, have you played Arena? And about one out of three people said, oh, I played it. Yeah, it's all right. I prefer paper. And that the second out of three would say, yeah, I actually started on Arena and I'm here tonight because this is my first paper event. I just wanted to see what the community was like, you know. And then another third was like, I don't care about that crap. I just play paper, right? But at least everybody had dabbled with it. Most everybody had tried it. But a good one out of three people at my local event was there. Because they had tried Arena and wanted to try the actual game.
I'm just glad it provides a tutorial finally after all these years, because the most, like, can you imagine trying to tell someone who doesn't know how to play, how to learn how to play on like Magic Online?
It's impossible.
Like, yeah.
I know how to play Magic and I can't play on Magic Online.
Oh yeah.
But like Arena, it's like, oh, you can say, oh yeah, it's free. Unlike Magic Online, which is 10 bucks for some reason. It's free. Sign up. There's a tutorial. You can just turn it off after that, but it'll take you through it and then go down to your card shop and get some cards. But there you go. You got a little tutorial on there. That'll help you out.
And I do. I like Arena has, like Ellis said earlier, I just like playing naked. I don't want to have to show up to my show. Like,
hang on. That's not what I said.
That's what you should have said, because I know you ain't wearing pajamas, man. I've been to your house. I've never been to your house. The point that I'm making is playing naked is great. Am I wrong?
I mean, you're not wrong.
You know, like, even it's why we do all this stuff. I mean, I'm not even wearing pants right now. It's just, you know, from the waist up for the purpose of the podcast.
Oh, yeah. Well, I always wondered about that because you're a snappy dresser, man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but you know, the camera just only goes so low. So,
yeah, for those of you listen to audio version of the podcast and never met the professor before, every time I've ever seen this man, he was in a nice button down, nice and iron pressed with a nice professionally tied tie.
Pressed.
It was when I saw it in person.
It wasn't though. That's the thing. I've never ironed anything, literally once. I do not take my stuff into the dry cleaners. I do not own an iron. This is thrift store merchandise. This jacket was $8 at a thrift store.
So it wasn't like passed down to you from your dead grandfather, like report of the week.
No.
Okay, good. Because I did notice it actually fits you, unlike Report of the Week. So
right,
but
I assumed you took it off of a dead history professor.
That's kind of like, you know, how it got to the thrift store.
Don't insult him. It was a lit professor. Come on.
Right, a history professor actually has more purpose.
But for those of you who don't know your story,
I can make that joke. I'm allowed, just by the way, I'm allowed to make those kind of jokes because I was a lit professor. So it's okay. You guys can't make them. But I can make them. A former lit professor.
So you were teaching lit on a university campus in...
Well, community college.
Community college at San Francisco, of all cities, right?
Well, I wasn't working in the city because they were not hiring. So I taught... I was living in the city and I was teaching outside the city. I taught in Oakland. I taught in Palo Alto. That was a commute. I taught all around town, but I never could get hired in the city proper.
What made you decide to create a Magic the Gathering channel? Like, what made you sit down and create your first video? That's always fascinating.
I wanted people to know which were the best card sleeves. It was going to be a one of. I was obsessed with keeping my cards because I really did. I'm not like people sometimes think I'm joking. I really kept my Magic cards in penny sleeves in high school because I wanted them to stay in perfect condition. And when I came back to Magic, I was no different. And I found that like even sleeved cards, some of them were really crappy. They'd let dirt and particles in the top, which would create little scrapes, tiny little rubs on the top. I hated that. And I bought every type of card sleeve that there was times two and tested them all out and would talk everyone's ear off about which are the better ones and what purposes. And well, I started double sleeving and all this stuff. And I was like, you know, when you make a post to MTG Salvation or Reddit, it disappears. And I wanted there to be a kind of permanent fixture of like consumer reports of here are the most common card sleeves on the market currently, and here is why these are good, these are bad, these are in between, and stuff. And it was a one-time thing. And then someone said, hey, can you do that for deck boxes? And I was like, yes, I can. And then it was like, play mats? Yeah. And then it was just like, and did you know you could wash those? Well, let me show you. And then it was portfolios and binders and three ring binders. And it just, and then it was everything. And then it just reached a point where it's like, all right, if it exists, I have to review it for Magic.
So it turns out
is machine washable.
Yeah,
playmats are machine washable. If it's,
which
it's
deck
cloth
box
and neoprene,
is machine washable?
It's cloth and neoprene. Put it in permanent press. You put a little bit of just regular color safe laundry detergent in. I actually recommend doing it with some other stuff load in the wash. You can put it on a low dry, but the best thing is just to take it out, lay it flat. That's the key thing because it can become wrinkled, and you want it to drip dry. A flat, like on a line or something like that. And so if you ever got like some ketchup or whatever, big gulp, you know, build your thunder muscle all over it.
Thunder muscle.
What, am I the only one who drinks thunder muscle?
Do you remember that old, you know, was like an old flash file? What was that called?
The
thunder muscle, was that actually what it was called?
Increasingly poor decisions of Todd Margett was thunder muscle.
Oh,
increasingly poor decisions.
That's a good show. That's on Netflix still.
Yeah. So yeah, you can wash your playmats.
It's fascinating to know that it's your OCD basically that started your YouTube, your wildly successful YouTube career.
Well, I mean, clearly you know exactly what you're talking about. You've done this research.
Yeah.
So you were that guy when I would buy like some sleeves at my local gaming store. You'd be the guy who would, like, sitting near the register and roll your eyes and go, "Oh my god, I can't believe he bought Dragon Shields."
Actually, gonna buy KCD. I did recommend Dragon Shields. Dragon Shields. I still recommend Dragon Shields. They're probably the best sleeve on the market currently. That's what I recommended back then. So I don't. You're wrong.
What if I bought Ultra Pro sleeves
back then? Ultra Pro, I once called the McDonald's of card sleeves.
I have bought so much stuff because of your stupid videos too. Like, I have a grimoire to keep my cube in, and all my cube cards are sleeved in Dragon Shield, but not double sleeved. F that.
You got a double sleeve. It protects them.
I bought a four binder based on your recommendation.
Oh, those are great. Yeah.
The
one thing I don't think that you mentioned is that they're quite sharp. It literally cut my hand open when I pulled it out of the package.
I don't know that I encountered that in my testing, I'm afraid. I did.
Maybe
not
I got an extra sharp
my
version.
Hand open on the binder, but I'm sorry to hear that happen.
No, it's okay. It's still the best binder I've ever had.
It is interesting that so you also do unboxings on your channel. I know a lot of people used to love my unboxings when I uploaded them to my channel. You only do about one per new set.
Yeah,
and
I don't do
it's
too
got a really cool
them,
structure. Tell them your structure, because it's really fascinating what you do.
Oh, I do a thing called the Booster Box game. So I actually am a big advocate. I mean, listen, if you like opening packs for fun, that's great. But if you're not drafting with those packs, the truth is you are very unlikely to get the cards that you need, enough of them to, you know, build a deck for Constructed. And a lot of times I would just hear people constantly say, hey, which booster box should I buy? Because I want to go down and play Friday Night Magic Standard. And it's like, listen, you buy that $100 booster box, but you're not even going to get a mono red deck out of it, even with trades and stuff, or it'd be highly unlikely and take a lot of work with trades. it's just not designed for that. And so I wanted to illustrate it. So I created the booster box game, which is I'm going to spend $100, which is what they cost on average, on a booster box, open it up. And for all the cards that are worth $2 or more, I'm going to add up the tally and I'm going to sell them. And I really sell them. And I'm going to see if I can get $100 in cards from my $100 box. And if I do, I'll buy another box and repeat the process and see how many times I can go. But eventually you end up with like a box with like $40 worth of cards in it. And it's always just like a nice way to illustrate, hey, look, you spent $100 on this, but you're not even getting $100 worth of cards. You spent $100 on the singles you need to build the decks that you want to play or go draft, or if you have fun. And again, like, listen, if you're someone who just like, hey man, I like to spend $20 on packs and sit down and it's fun. What are you harping on that? I'm not do that. It's just for someone who's like, hey, I really want to get my deck together for Friday Night Magic. I want to spend $100. Don't do it on a box. It's not designed to give you the cards you need to build that deck.
Right.
It's not good monetary value, but
it might be good. Yeah, that's the thing. I'm not ever against you. If you have fun, you do you. You know, go have fun. The Magic's a game. Go have fun. Yeah, whenever, but, you know, it's not that. It's just you're better off going down to your local game store and buying the singles that you need. You want to go get those singles.
Whenever
you're getting a lot more bang for your buck just buying the singles. Nine times out of ten.
Whenever I crack a box on Twitch or YouTube or elsewhere, I always say, let me crack a box so you don't have to. You get the joy of watching me waste my money on these lottery boxes, because they are loot boxes. I mean, they are the original loot box, right? Like, let's just be honest.
The original Skinnerware, yes. Right?
Yeah, the good news is you can actually buy the singles you want directly from a friend or from somebody else or from a gaming store. And that's always the best way to play this game. But it is designed to just one more pack, just one more crack, but just one more pack of crack. So one more little high. Ooh, look at this.
And it's very interesting that Richard Garfield spent most of the rest of, like, I mean, I don't have the whole list of every single, the guy's a genius. He's made a million games, but most of his returns to card games seem to have been attempts to never let that happen again. I've heard him speak out against, he doesn't like how much money people have to spend just to sit down and play. Netrunner that he did next was a living card game. And then even going all the way forward to like Keyforge, where you just buy a deck complete and there's no buying singles. And sure, you buy more packs or decks with Keyforge, which is very addictive. But I can just buy one package of Keyforge and have a deck to play with forever if I'm satisfied.
Right. Yeah. Even Artifact, may it rest in peace, was designed to, even though you can buy singles, to keep the cost under a certain amount. It was always very cheap. I bought an Artifact deck that I owned, I think, maybe 3 cards for out of 45. Cost me $3 to buy the entire deck.
Yeah.
And that was fairly at its peak.
Went up in smoke, didn't it?
Oh, my God. Recently, they were at Forbes for having less than 1,500 players.
Oof. Yep,
down from I think 60,000 at release, or 66,000.
Yeah, it was
and
a stillbirth.
Still 1,500 more than Hex has.
It was what's really interesting about Artifact is that it had all this negative press when it went live. If you remember that about the monetization, it made like the front page of Reddit. So I think a lot of people who would have given Artifact a chance didn't, because they heard that bad news. And then like Steam and Valve have always been very, very quick to respond to negative criticism. So they had that stuff fixed within 4 hours of that going live on Reddit. Didn't matter. Most people never heard about the fixes, the free ways to plays, the free ways to draft, and the fact that they added like a grind to it so you could earn more product. And then it got even more favorable as it went. That was the biggest blow to it, I think. But the second is, you want to talk about complicated. Richard Garfield, if he's left unchecked, will go completely insane. Like, it's impossible to understand that man's designs some of the times.
Richard Garfield is like if Professor Xavier decided instead of equal rights for mutants, he wanted to devote his life to just making increasingly more complex games. It's like, that's literally what you're dealing with, that level of intellect here. And like, hats off to him. He's a hero of mine, but the guy is a staggering genius, and he needs to always make sure there's some dum-dums like me in the room going, wait, what?
Right.
Can we take that down a level there, sir?
But he's like, look, man, I can make a card game that plays just like Defense of the Ancients, or Dota, I should call it. And there's 3 lanes, and you have to control all 3 lanes at once. And there's random minions that show up, and it's going to be easy to watch, even though you can't fit it all on one screen. What? Richard, man, calm. Like, why was nobody in the room to be like, Richard, calm down, dude.
Could you tone it back a little bit? I loved that game. That game is great. It is incredibly complicated and exhausting to play.
And impossible to watch.
And grind 30 games of Artifact like I came with Magic. Yeah. I'll fall asleep.
Yeah.
I'll pass out. It's too much. And it's impossible to watch. And that's, it's a shame, but that matters so much in this age of influencers, of Twitch, of streaming, of all of this kind of coverage.
He also, if you ever dabbled with any of his like social games, he's insanely good at those. Like Hivemind,
Hivemind is so good.
50 hours of Hivemind at this point. It's so good. I can't get enough of his social games. Or even like if some of his little one shot games, like one shot. Guillotine was fascinating. What was the Tokyo game, like the monsters fighting
Tokyo.
Monsters?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, if you edited...
I still have that on my shelf. That's a great one.
If you edit the deck, because there's a lot of just like bad, dead cards in there, but if you edit the deck, because he's a big fan of just like very narrow cards sometimes. And so you'd have like a lot of narrow, narrow cards in the Tokyo game. But if you edited that deck, it's just fun. It's just a good game.
Robo Rally, that's another one.
Robo Rally, absurdly complicated. And nobody's done that either. So what was interesting about Robo Rally, for the listeners who don't know, is you played a robot inside of a rally, surprise, surprise, and there was other robots, and you would program your turn based on the cards you were dealt. So you'd be dealt, like, let's say, 8 cards, and then you would program 5 of them in a direct order. The problem is, you also didn't know what the people around you, or even maybe necessarily what the board itself was going to do, so you might program forward, 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 left, turn left, forward, forward, to get to the flag that you need to get to. The problem is, before you even execute your first round in your program, someone might bump you over one. So now you go forward, forward into a grinder and get destroyed. And it was such a complicated game, and it was so impossible, but it was funny. Like, it was one of the very few comedy, because you would never do what you thought you were going to do. And so sometimes it was just best to just spin in a circle and see who bumps you where, and I don't know, it was a great game, man. But it's complicated, complicated, complicated stuff.
Cool.
Have you ever met Richard Garfield? I can't remember.
I've never met Richard Garfield, but I know people. This is me. I know people who have met Richard Garfield. I absolutely know several people who have met Richard Garfield, and they all tell me that he's really, really nice. Do you know what his favorite Magic card is still to this day?
What?
Charizard. That is, he's still, that also shows a certain level of, like, he's on his own plane of existence, because Charizard is his favorite Magic card. The Gathering.
And for those of you who don't know, that is a game. It is a card that very much mimics the Arabian Nights. What is it? 40 Days and 40 Nights or whatever.
Long story.
So the legend of it is Sherazad was due to be betrothed to the emperor or the king, and he would marry a woman, have sex with her, and then brutally murder her when he was bored with her. And so when it was her turn to marry this dude, she's like, look, but if I will, let me tell you a story first. And then they get to the end of the story, and he's like, well, how does it end? And she's like, well, you'll have to keep me alive another day to find out.
Right.
And so what this card does, it mimics that within the confines of Magic. So you stop the game you're currently playing to play a second game of Magic, which could, you have 4 Charizards in your deck, you might end up playing a new subgame, a subgame of a subgame of a subgame of a sub. Well, they banned it in tournaments immediately, right?
Yeah, it's banned in every single format. You can't even play it in Commander.
Yep.
That you can't play it in Vintage. You can't play it. It's just ridiculous. It is banned everywhere. Amazingly, it's also a fortune. If you wanted to buy it, probably just as it's like just a collector's piece through intrinsic value or something. But yeah, that's his favorite Magic card.
I do still retain one Charizard, and so I'd love to get that signed by Richard one day. Didn't know that was his favorite card.
That's a good goal.
Yeah, that's weird stuff.
That's a good goal.
And you know,
and speaking of old cards, I looked up for you. You said you gave away those candelabras, and I just want to let you know, so you don't feel bad, that they're only worth $800 each now. They're only $800 each. So
I got like $20 to pop for them. It's so interesting, because when I came back to the game, I met my friend Ricky, who bought the majority of those cards from me, and he was getting out of the game. And so he took the folder that had most of my Arabian Nights and Antiquities cards in it to Star City Games, like event, and then sold it to the dealer. And I'm like, how much do you sell that folder for? And he goes, well, keep in mind, I bought it off you for about $200. And I'm like, yeah, most of that stuff out of there. And he goes, but there's a lot of stuff in there I added too. I made like $5,000. And I'm like,
nice.
And now it's been 10 years.
Yeah.
So how much money did he lose? Never sell your Magic cards. That's what we've learned
here today. Anybody watching this right now who played like in high school and hasn't played since and thinks maybe mom or dad still has your old collection in the garage, because that's the only story, that's the story that you keep hearing is like, oh, I think mom still saved those in a box, you know, in the back of the garage. Let me go check. You might just have some of those $800 cards or even just a whole stack of those $500 cards is pretty nice little thing to find.
Yeah,
and you can mail them to P.O. Box
10738, Fayetteville, Arkansas, 72704. I've actually had fans offer me their Magic collections. Like, I have an old Magic collection. I'm like, where is it from? They're like, 98. I'm like, okay, you need to take that to a gaming store and have them price it. You need to price it yourself. He's like, I'll just give it to you. No. No. You might be giving me your children's tuition. So, no. Right? Send me pictures of it, and if it does look like it's all junk, then I'll take it, just like something as a gift from a fan, right? But we're going to determine if there's value in it first. Well, you should look through it for me once you get it, and if it's worth something, send it back. If you send me a Black Lotus, look, I have integrity, dude, but there's only so far that goes. When you send me a $20,000 card, I'm going to be tempted. That's what
I
I'm
have
saying.
Integrity. I don't have a Black Lotus.
Right, yeah. I only have so much integrity that if you send me a $25,000 bill, it's going to test me, son. Okay? I don't care how bad your kid needs college, so you better do it. But if you played Magic anywhere, say, 94 to 2000, oh my God, you could be sitting on a fortune, at least a few months' mortgage. And if you played Magic probably from 2000 to 2010, there's still a chance you have some $200-$400 cards in there.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. Ask mom and dad if that box is still in the garage and go check it out.
Yeah. And if you played from, say, 2010 forward, chances are you have a box of garbage, but
I can't wait for the YouTube comments. They're all going to be those horror stories of like, yeah, I threw them out. I threw out my cards from 94. Right. I threw out my cards from 98.
I had boxes.
My mom got mad at me for not cleaning my room, and so as punishment, she threw out my Magic cards.
Oh no!
It was like $20 worth of cards, so it wasn't like a bad thing, you know, like that bad of a thing. And it's like it was filled with boxes or whatever.
Yeah.
They would tell me, my mom, growing up, like, and I started playing Magic in college, but she's like, you need to stay away from that Dungeons and Dragons. That Dungeons and Dragons is the evil. So immediately I went to find somebody who played Dungeons and Dragons, right? And I got more into GURPS than D&D. But when I came home from college for the summer and I stayed with my mom to help out around the house, I brought my Magic cards home and she saw them and she's like, what is this? And I'm like, oh, it's a game I play. And she goes, doesn't that game have demons and stuff in it? And I'm like, Mom, it's 94. Can we not care about if there's a demon printed on my card game? And she's just like, well, you need to get that stuff out of my house. I'm like, well, I can keep it at a friend's place where I play Magic at his place, so I'll just leave it there. And she's like, I don't want that witchcraft in my house. Mom!
It's wizardcraft. Say it's a religious game. Look, it's Sarah Angel, Wrath of God. See, there's all the sinners, Wrath of God, that are all getting blown away.
There you go.
But there was demonic panic for that game in the 90s. I still can't believe it to this day. And so one of my favorite things, I still have a few copies of the common card Unholy Strength. Unholy Strength, originally in Alpha Beta Unlimited, had a pentagram behind the guy who's like flexing out. He's like flexing out, and he's got like a pentagram burning behind him. And so instead they removed the pentagram but still left the guy flexing out,
and it looks so weird.
And it's just a big yellow background with a guy flexing in the corner,
and they also still called it Unholy Strength,
right?
Which so it's just no it's sense. Just we took the pentagram out of Unholy Strength but kept it Unholy Strength,
and they made the demons beasts,
right?
Like Number of the Beast. Like, that's still close enough. Come on. And they left Sarah Angel was still in the game, which is still iconography, right? Like, you're still not supposed to draw angels and stuff unless it's for holy purpose. I don't know, man. It's so weird how the world has changed. Probably not for the better.
I'll never forget. And this was such a funny thing. We were in line for I was with my friend and his dad, and we were in line to buy, not like one of those giant lines, like a regular line at a bookstore, to buy like the third Harry Potter book for my friend's kid sister. And so we're in line and like, you know, my friend's dad is holding the Harry Potter book, and this woman walks up to him and she goes, you know, those books promote Satanism, right? And I'll never forget it. My friend's dad looks at her without even a blink, and he just goes, good.
Hail Satan. This book is great. Hail Satan. Yeah, why, man, it's so weird. And then, like, I went to the Mortal Kombat 11 reveal, and it's just, like, Scorpion bursting out of hell, punching people's eyeballs out of their socket into their mouse, hitting people in the head with their own, hitting people in the crotch with their own skulls. Like, why is that a thing
so
you can
Mortal
do?
It's Mortal Kombat.
Yeah, it's Mortal Kombat, right?
No, that sounds like Mortal Kombat.
And nobody cares.
I'm glad some things don't change.
Some people do care.
Oh, yeah, but those,
definitely like, people on the internet, they care a lot.
Well, what they care about is they're afraid that Scarlet might accidentally show cleavage in that game. That's what they care about. But if Scarlet is eviscerated and has her intestines ripped out, or she pulls somebody's blood out and turns it into a scythe and it cuts them in half, those same people don't seem to care. But if she accidentally wasn't wearing what she's wearing and accidentally showed a little cleavage in this game, they would lose their minds, which is insane to me.
It is odd what people choose to care about.
Yeah, violence is, you know, scary, and sex is not scary. Sex is great. So when you get mad about sex, that's weird. When you're mad about violence, I'm like, oh, I kind of get that. Yeah, that's scary. Like, I don't want to die. That reminds me of dying. I don't want to die, right? Magic has really gone kind of in that direction, too, where I think they finally embrace the fact that they're kind of a kid's game, so they've really scaled down the art to be more technically beautiful and less, like, necessarily gory or less necessarily sexualized.
Not less gory. Go look through some of those Rakdos and Golgari cards. I think literally in this set there's a troll eating someone's gallbladder. I guess that is still technically less gory than previous.
About like the Return to Innistrad block, where we have like the shirtless male vampires covered in blood, like licking blood off of each other's chests. Or there's the card. It's supposed to be from the position, the point of view of the victim getting cannibalized. Right,
that one's so creepy.
I know, it's one of my favorites. So
creepy. I love Magic the Gathering art, and there's a whole debate between like old art and new art, and a lot of people like to hurl this idea that the only reason people like me and probably you, Boogie, really like some of the old art is just a nostalgia factor, and that if you look at it technically, like, you're correct to say that new art being made today is really talented and technically gifted, and we have such amazing artists doing this artwork. And then you look back at, like, you know, some of these old arts, and it maybe looks goofy to some, and you and me look at it and we're like, oh, I love that card, I love that art, and they might point out it's not as technically gifted, but I don't think it's just nostalgia.
I don't think so either.
It was imaginative, it was colorful, it was evocative of emotion and idea, and it maybe it wasn't as technically gifted, but I don't think that's the only quality to art, is just technical prowess. And I think that there's room for both. And I like that. I think they are starting to give a little more freedom to the artists in some of the newer pieces. There's a lot of great art in this new set, and there's a lot of great art from Fallen Empires, and it's great. You know, I really like Magic art. They say that if cards were just text, the game would not be the same.
Absolutely not.
Away all the art, and we're just dealing with the rules text. You lose so much. The art is so important, and it's what, you know, when I was on my hiatus, all I thought about was the card art.
Yep.
Jacob? And less than what the cards did.
To speak to what you were saying, I think that Magic went through a period where they wanted all of the art to feel like it all came from exactly the same place. So the art direction, everything was beautiful, but it kind of felt homogenous. Everything looked very similar, and that wasn't the case in older sets. You would get cards that were on the same plane, but they looked wildly different, and it made them interesting and memorable.
Right. And I think that both have their points. Like, it's fair to say, hey, look, like I remember, I think it was Fallen Empires, where you'd have like Elvish warrior, and one of them, the elf, he has like glowing blue skin and yellow hair. And then in the other one, it looks more like a Lord of the Rings elf with, you know, more human, you know, skin tones and just pointed ears. And it's like, wait, those are supposed to be the same, like world and plane. And they look like wildly different because there was no coordination between them.
Right.
And so that's good for them to have like art direction that says, okay, on Ravnica, here's what goblins look like, but on Mirrodin, here's what goblins look like. Like, goblins have like a species look on these planes, but I do still feel it's important to give the artists artistic freedom to then take that information and go a little, you know, creative
right.
with it.
So here's, yeah, so here's my little rant on that. So I do think you're right when it comes to stuff like Phil Foglio. His art was very unique, very cartoony and goofy, and it looked like a comic book a lot of the times. So
I loved his art.
Yeah, nostalgia is probably, he's probably not technically what you, technically very talented.
He's an award-winning artist. Right. He's a famous comic book illustrator.
Right, but maybe that doesn't fit the world of magic, right? Like, that's not the art direction they want to take anymore, and I'm okay with that. But Anson Maddox and Melissa Benson, Anson did this horrifically just detailed, gruesome stuff. Yeah. Melissa Benson did some of the most beautiful watercolors I've ever seen in my life. Shiv and Dragon, to this day, they still print that card, and I wish it still had the exact same art because it's gorgeous. The art Melissa did that was technically beautiful and just gorgeous, and there's no reason those artists shouldn't be allowed to paint for magic today. You could give them art direction. And when it comes to somebody like Rebecca Gay, as I believe is
it, it is Gay.
Rebecca Gay, when her art is otherworldly, right? I saw a squirrel token designed by her the other day that used, what is it, the parallax or the spiral style, and so the tail was spiraled perfectly mathematically.
Oh, that's Therese Nielsen's squirrel token.
Oh, is that Therese Nielsen? Okay, Therese Nielsen.
Much talent.
And
yes.
So they did go back to form with at least a few cards in Ravnica. There's a black spell that says black and two or black and one, sacrifice two creatures, draw three cards, and the art on that is just bizarre. It looks like old school magical.
I don't know. We're getting it back. I'm very happy.
And so the fact that they're starting to sneak stuff like that and people are taking notice and we're not just happy with it, we're celebrating, we're glad, like this card, wow, this card stands out. That's what made it interesting, is that Melissa Benson's art stood out, Phil Foglio's art stood out. Anson Maddox's Living Wall, for those of you who have never seen it, Living Wall is supposed to be an artifact that's alive. So he created just a big grayish mat of flesh with like eyeballs in it and teeth in it and a fetus dead in the center. And it's kind of impressionist. So in that small magic card art, you wouldn't notice the fetus at first. Someone had to point it out to you. And then once they did, you would never not notice this fetus in this living wall. And you're like, why did this get put on a card? How is this? But what better way to exemplify what a living wall is? And a lot of sets, Theros specifically, just look like the same artist drawing the same plane over and over and over again. Looks like screenshots from a video game. And that is not interesting, right? What is interesting is this is Therese Nielsen's take on Ravnica. Mm-hmm. This is Anson Maddox's take on Ravnica. This is John Avon's take on what an island would be in Zendikar. And wow. And that's those little statements, right? Especially when you're doing a mythic card that's going to see tournament play. Something, you know, like some of my favorite art is on miserable, bad cards. And some of my favorite cards have miserable art. But I will Hymn to Turok, which remains my favorite card to this day, to play, never have played on me. But the wolf art on that one is incredible. It's in
totally 90s.
Yeah.
So
totally
goofy. 90s. I love
it's
it.
It's such a goofy art. Just love that wolf howling the Hymn to Turok and causing people to discard spells. And it's just, I don't know, man. So yeah, I really feel like this Ravnica got some of that mojo back. And I really hope whoever is in charge of art over there at Wizards of the Coast right now, I hope you hear this. And I hope you hear me saying, congratulations, you're doing a great job. And I know a lot of people out there do balk at the idea that we went into a less violent, less sexy, less adult themes. And I honestly don't care.
I want the game to be good and I want the art to be good.
Yeah. Right.
I don't care if the themes are, Lorwyn is one of my favorites. Sets.
It's such a cool set. Yeah.
We might be going back there soon.
I don't know if I want to do that.
But we're starting to see some little hints. We're starting to just see like the little hints that might be signposts saying Return to Lorwyn is in the works. And you know, the best thing about Return to Lorwyn is not the fairy tale setting, not the by day Mother Goose, by night Brothers Grimm transition, but the fact that there are no bloody humans on Lorwyn, and
Amen.
So modern humans will not get anything from that entire set. which
they'll
is
still they'll great. Still find a way to work something into the sideboard. They started playing Knight of Autumn.
Therefore, there are humans.
For those of you who are still listening, who haven't played a lot of Magic, Lorwyn was them going to almost storybook fantasy with giants and goofy looking goblins and goblins that throw fish at your head and just like a kind of a child's version of Lord of the Rings. And then night fell and it all went to hell. And
they literally have a card of a evil tree folk drinking the blood of an elf, and the flavor text is just like, oh, there's nothing better on a cold Shadowmoor night than you know, a drought of elf, you know, hot blood, you mm-hmm. know, to keep you warm. And it's like literally just got this screaming elf being, you know, sucked dry by a leafless tree folk. And it's like, yeah, that's some pretty dark stuff. That's
it,
some pretty.
It started pretty as Disney and ended Brothers Grimm. Right? Yep. It was such a cool concept, and why we can't do that again, I don't know.
Might?
Yeah, I really hope we do.
I hope we do. One last rant that I have, and I don't know too much about the truth of this, but I'm curious because I know that both Professor, especially, you guys are more knowledgeable in this kind of thing than me. When it comes to magic art, a lot of old art was painted. It was oil on canvas. It was acrylic. It was whatever. And these days, there's been a huge shift to digital art. And I understand that, you know, technology has vastly improved and a lot of artists work digitally. And I don't want to rain on any of that at all. I think that those artists are just as talented. It's just a different medium. But I do wonder if that shift has more to do with pricing than anything else, because oil on canvas is fucking expensive. It is expensive to commission a painting that is this big and, you know, uses those paints. It takes a week to dry and all of this stuff. So especially when you're trying to then get a good image of it down small, I wonder how much of this kind of shift in art direction was driven by price point.
Have you ever seen how much an original Magic artwork, even from the most recent set, even if a non-amazing card goes for, it's far more lucrative. And I'm pretty sure this is true, that it's far more lucrative for an artist to have a physical painting to sell afterwards, because they go for like $10,000 plus.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Each. And like even like ones where I think it was Ryan Pancoast who put up a common, and he even said like, hey, it's just a common. It was like a vanilla common, and it went for like $8,000. And he was like, I can't believe this. I didn't think anyone would care for like what's typically a filler card. And everyone's like, but the art's amazing. I, you know, this and that, and the bidding was high. So I think that it's actually far more lucrative for them to do the traditional hand and paint art, but it has to do with whether or not they can personally, I think it's up to them to get it scanned and sent to Wizards in the proper format. And okay. So like, I know guys like Noah Bradley, he actually paints giant oil canvases of his lands. They're huge, if you've ever seen a picture. And he has these giant industrial level scanners that he takes sections of and then reassembles the work digitally, but that's not something everyone knows how or can, you know, like have a setup to do. And also a lot of people these days are just learning technically on digital, you know, pads and stuff.
Absolutely.
I don't know how to oil paint, or they prefer not to and stuff. I don't know that there's an actual demand by Wizards. That's a good question. But from what I hear, it comes down to just how that artist works.
Okay.
Prof, did you ever buy?
That's great to hear. I'd love to know that.
Do you ever buy an original art piece?
The original art community has been trying for years to get me to buy an original art piece, and I refuse because even the cheapest ones that are out there are thousands of dollars, and I just can't justify it. I'm like, that is half of a modern deck right there. You know, so I just can't justify that price.
Well, what would you want to own the most?
Oh my God. You know what I'd like to own the most would be when I started my YouTube channel and I wasn't planning on becoming, you know, an actual business with it and everything. I just took the artwork for 7th edition Inspiration, which is this hand-painted thing of this wizard guy reading a book and kind of having an aha moment and going like,
oh,
this.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
I love it. And for the first year, it took about a year before I hired someone to design a logo and stuff like that for me. And so when I see that artwork, even though the card isn't that great, I always think of my channel and it's the one card. And I also think of that too. It's like Inspiration, aha, you know? Yeah. And so I did say to a couple of the original art people. I said, do you know who has that? And a lot of people who own original art, they don't even like it to be known that they have it because they get bothered by people trying to buy it off of them so much. So it's very secretive for, in some cases.
I remember briefly, I went to a Grand Prix. I think one of the very first like Grand Prix, and Noah Bradley was there, and he did some really great art, the original Sarah Angel, the original Frozen Shade. And he signed some cards for me.
Douglas Schuler.
Yeah, I just looked at it. I don't know why I said Noah Bradley. Douglas Schuler. Frozen Shade. Was it Unholy Strength that he did?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah,
I think
he did that one. He did the original Sarah Angel. And then he did some like original arts, including like this weird mashup of Sarah Angel wearing go-go boots on like a mountaintop with Frozen Shades like chasing him. And I went to his booth and like introduced myself. And this is back when I was doing okay with my first small business doing web design. And I'm like, hey, so you got stuff for someone? He's like, yeah. And I'm like, I'll have one. And it's like, which one do you want? I'm like, no, I'll have one of everything. Go ahead and ship, block it up. Cause it's only like $15 a print and they were pre-matted. And I'm like, this is ludicrous how little you are charging and you're signing everything. And like this is a limited edition print. And he's like, yeah, 500. I'm printing 500 of these. And this is number 133 and this 233. And I'm like, well, then they're signed already. Oh my God, I'll have everything. Thank you. And so I spent like $200 and that's all I could spend. And I wanted to spend more because I had $1,000 burning in my pocket for that Grand Prix. And, I'm like, do you have any like original arts? And he goes, well, I do still have a few pieces left. If you contact me. And I ended up, I think, writing him, and he ended up saying like, he had a piece for like 500 and I don't remember which piece it was. I don't remember. I was like, oh, who the hell is paying $500 for one piece of art?
Do you own any original? Do you own any?
No.
Boogie?
I still have all those prints, but
that's what I think when I went to your place, you had them like they're lit and everything, like in a glass case. And I think I was like very intimidated the first time I went over there. And I was just like, oh my God, he's got the original. That's probably the original. And I'm just like, just act cool about it. I'm just like,
yes. I would have killed. I knew then what I knew now. I would have kept my magic cards. I would have bought the original art. I would have kept all my signed cards. I would have, you know,
hindsight, right?
Yeah, hindsight's 20/20.
Jacob, what about you? What original art would you want to own the most?
That's tough. I really like the Niles Ham planes. The field with kind of the
is that the Scottish horizon.
I'm looking this up. Hold on, what?
So I don't know. There's a set of basics that are based off of actual places in the world. I think the forest is in Japan or Korea. It's in Korea. And then there's a Scottish Highland Plains.
Those are so pretty.
Those are pretty. No, this is just a core set planes that they've reprinted a couple of times. I mean, they reprinted it in M19. It's just a Plains art by Niles Ham. And I don't know. For some reason, it really speaks to me.
Ellis, what about you?
I'm trying to find it. I would love Platinum Angel by Brom, who is my favorite magic artist and is also a writer now. He writes good books. He does not, unfortunately, make art for magic anymore, but he's responsible for some fairly iconic stuff like Platinum Angel, Gemstone Mine, Mog Fanatic. I'm trying to think of other ones. Majee the Lion and Oath of Ghouls. So those are a little bit less played cards, but I love Platinum Angel just artistically. It's a fine card. It's a very unique card, and I do like it for that reason, but man, I would love to own that.
I would love to have Anson Maddox's Singer Vampire from Alpha Beta Unlimited. But I would
had the pleasure. Go on.
I would hang it sideways. Because I always felt like the art, the blood is dripping down the face, and it looks like we originally should be looking up with the blood dripping down, which is one of the weirdest things about it. I would want to hang it sideways. So you have a story about that, Professor?
I was just assuming he was running really fast and the blood was...
Right. Oh, that might be, yeah.
I had the pleasure of creeping out some like 12-year-olds who were magic players that had never seen the art, and they reprint Sengir Vampire a lot, and I think it was like M12 or M13. Sengir Vampire was just an uncommon, and they were going on and on about how they love Sengir Vampire, and the art on that is rad and stuff. And I said, yeah, but have you seen the original Sengir Vampire art? And they didn't know. They were like 12, and they were like, they had no idea there was old art. And so I pulled it up on my phone and they were like, ooh, whoa, that's so freaky. He's like licking a vein of, you know.
Yeah, Anson Maddox art will always be what magic is. I mean, that and Phil Foglio and Melissa Benson will always be what magic Maddox art is supposed to look to like to me.
Man, Maddox still is. I just saw him at a GP. He's got like, he'll do, he's painted Sengir vampire on playmats, but doing new things and stuff. Like, he's still at those GPs.
He's not the artist. There's an Alpha Beta Unlimited artist has some very regrettable opinions on his website. Who is that?
Yes. It's the guy who did Invoke Prejudice. Don't Google him.
Do not Google that card either.
You shouldn't have said it. Now everyone's going to Google it.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, he's got Invoke Prejudice. I will say it. Invoke Prejudice has some imagery that is very regrettable.
Harold McNeil. That's not the problem. The problem is that the guy has got, you know, super duper level, you know, like
conspiracy theories part of it too, right?
I haven't personally. I mean, I don't know. Yeah. I believe like he got caught a couple times at a GP, literally like saying to some kids like, "Hey, you like that? Check this out." And it's just filled with like, you know,
and
not Nazi supermen are our superiors level.
Oh
level.
My gosh. Okay.
Yeah,
so
like imagery like that, like really like.
So when like I mentioned Anson, far out there, when so. I mentioned Anson Maddox original, I was like, man, I hope that's not who that was.
No. Someone else.
So I don't know, man. I guess if you have a card game that lasts for 26 years and has, what, 22,000 unique pieces of art in it, eventually you're going
to... I think that's a pretty good track record. You got one Lunatic and Quentin Hoover did Earthbind. And other than that, you're good.
Yeah, Earthbind was another art that just, to this day, I was like, what am I looking at? Wait...
I gotta look at this. Nobody else Google it though.
You know, feel free to Google. This one's not that offensive. It's just it's a fairy that has been bound to the ground by
None of what Harold McNeil did for the game was it's a little weird that the card has Klansmen on it. And
oh,
stuff.
It's very weird that the kid has Klansmen.
What I mean is that his private collection that he would show off at GPs it's and on his website insane. And stuff was where you went into that right. that. Territory of mm-hmm. of some crazy stuff right. And everything and such, but yeah, I don't even know if he still has like I don't know
but I'm glad to see Anson Maddox is still drawing for the game occasionally. I'm glad to see he's still at GPs, right?
Yep.
Whatever happened to Melissa and Benson? Like, does she still exist?
I bought you can go to Melissa Benson's website and she sells prints, and she seriously, like, I think it was like $20, $30. And if you give her $20, $30 extra, she'll draw whatever you want in the border.
Oh, wow.
The print. And so I bought a nightmare print and I said, I love Sheevan Dragon. Can you draw Sheevan Dragon in the border? And she did. And it's awesome. I've got it hung upstairs and it's so cool because she did it. She just took out some pencils and she colored it in and everything. Like, not super professionally, like it's just a quick sketch, but it's still from her and it's rad and it's neat, you know, like these artists are available to speak to, like people who I get asked a lot, like, wow, where'd you get that print? And it's like, just start by Googling their name. Mm-hmm. Most of them have web stores, many of them have emails and Twitters, and they're happy to talk to you. You know, and if you do go to a GP, sorry, Magic Fest, if you do go to a Magic Fest at which GPs take place, you know, go up to the artists and say hi. They're some of the friendliest, most welcoming people that you'll encounter. And if Harold McNeil asks if you want to see some of his special artwork, you just say no.
Very, very much no.
And you say, no, thank you. And you go the opposite direction. You go over there.
When we started this episode, I knew it was going to be narrow because we knew we were going to talk a lot about magic. But no, we talked about artists you've never heard of and drawing art you've never seen, because that's how narrow we wanted to get on this particular episode.
No, it's not narrow. It's wide. Anybody that is like, I don't want to play card games, that's not something that I'm into. You like art, right? Just check out Magic the Gathering art. Even if you never want to play the game, go look at it for a source of amazing fantasy art, sci-fi art, steampunk art. It's got all kinds of stuff. And you can find crazy, amazing, talented, rad artists that you would have never heard of otherwise.
That also work outside of the magic space.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Yep.
They're artists as professionals.
Scott draws for Hearthstone. I know that everybody here loves that game so much. He's a super nice guy, though. I met him at a GP back when they were GPs and not Magic Fests.
And hey,
and if you like Hearthstone, good for you. Good.
You enjoy what you want to enjoy. You enjoy your crappy crap. When Ben Brode left, I still play Hearthstone every day, by the way. I hate. Yeah. But I just do my dailies, grind my gold, you know, do the tavern brawl each week or whatever. And when Ben Brode left, I was afraid that game would like slow down and stop being as creative and fun. And wow, did it. It got like they stopped even getting innovative at all. It's just like, here's a gnome. Okay, what's it do? It's a gnome. It's got bodies on it. Go. I'm like, all right, man, I guess.
It's got bodies on it.
The magnetic mechanic was the last interesting thing they did, so that was kind of cool. But so we should talk about video games a little bit here. Professor, do you play any games other than, like, Magic card games, D&D, that kind of thing?
I'm always behind. Like, listen, it's like, do you play video games? Yeah, I play 10-year-old, 20-year-old video games because I'm not with it. Like, you said you wanted to talk about Anthem, and, like, I'm so disconnected from Anthem. Like, maybe in 5 years I'll check it out, although it's a Memorpager, so it'll, like, that doesn't work that way. But, like, I came to Skyrim late, and I loved it, and I came to, you know, like Fallout late, but I love it. And, like, I've always got, like, this time delay on me. But it's great because I also bought those games for when they were on special on Steam for $8.99 for the collector's edition.
It's funny
when I see the prices that brand new games cost, I'm like, now I'll catch you in 5 years.
I got two things to say about that. Number one, you are a parent, so every parent I've ever known is on that schedule, to be honest with you, right? Hey, I can't wait to play this new Super Mario game, Super Mario Brothers 3, right? Secondly, how telling is it that the professor knows almost nothing about Anthem, but he knows that it'll be dead at least in 10 years when he could ever actually afford to play it, because it's a stupid MMO light game that is not going to be successful, unfortunately. So
it's a bummer to me. I was watching your video, Boogie, talking about it, because you said you wanted to talk about it on this podcast. I don't know anything really about it, but I was watching the video, and right away I was like, whoa, those graphics look amazing. You said it's like Iron Man. I was like, that's so cool, Iron Man game. And then I saw a little other guy out there with a little name floating above, and I went, oh no, it's
multiplayer. Yeah.
Oh
yeah.
Give me like Fallout New Vegas, but I'm Iron Man and in a jungle or whatever.
Right.
Like, that sounds awesome.
Right. See, that's why
have somebody tell me I need to fly up and get 10 of this or whatever.
In five,
come back, but I don't want to deal with other people.
In 5 to 6 years, you need to play some of the really good games that came out this last year, like God of War and Spider-Man. Those are great single player games, man. Like, you want to feel like Spider-Man. The new Spider-Man game will make you feel like Spider-Man, says every journalist and YouTuber for some reason. But it did make me feel like Spider-Man.
And well, there you go. You're saying it too.
Yeah, this game did make... I unironically said it in my video before I knew it was going to be a meme. I did. No, I was like, man, I really felt like Spider-Man. And then people were like, oh, they kept repeating it in the comments. And I'm like, what are you doing? Oh, shit. Everyone said it. But it did. Buddy. It made me feel like Spider-Man. I was skeeting all over the place, dude. Yeah, what is the last game?
Hang on. I don't remember that in the comic.
Oh,
then you weren't reading Spider-Man.
Yeah,
that's true.
I was reading the Japanese bootlegs where you can do whatever you want to with copyright over there. He was skeeting all over Donald Duck. It was great. So what is the last game you played, Professor, video game-wise? Oh, God.
MTG Arena does not count.
Oh, MTG Arena does not count. No. Oh, the last video game I played is actually the one series that actually makes me buy it when it comes out, which is Pokemon Let's Go Eevee. Pokemon Let's
Go
Eevee.
That was a lot of fun,
I have many opinions on that game.
Well, give us some opinions on that game.
Well, it's not a real Pokemon game.
No, it is
not. It's amazing. It's amazing, the graphics, the Pokemon following you, the scenery, the going back to Kanto and stuff, but I was so disappointed that it's not a bad, I really loved it, but it's not a real Pokemon game. It's the first console, I guess you could say, version of an app called Pokemon Go. And and it's Pokemon Go on your console. And that's fascinating to me that they did that, but it was really like, let's make a version of Pokemon Go that you play on your Switch. And they did an amazing job with like the environment and interacting with the Pokemon and stuff. And I love that because that's one of the things I really appreciate. But where it fell short is the aspects where, like, say, in the most recent Pokemon game, Sun and Moon, you know, all the more hardcore things like EV training, breeding. There's no breeding in Let's Go Pikachu Eevee. And a lot of other aspects of the real Pokemon games are not in Let's Go Eevee. And also it's just the original Pokemon and the Alolan versions. And that's really disappointing to me because you forget now that we have like 20,000 Pokemon, how few just 150, maybe plus a couple dozen are. And it's just like, cool, do you want to be a grass type trainer? You got three different Pokemon to choose from, and two of them are poison grass types, you know? And it's just like, it's like you get to the Elite Four, I remember, and it's like, I'm a dragon type trainer. There's one dragon type in the game, and I've got four of them, you know?
Right.
Like it's a lot cooler now, where then you go to the dragon trainer that you face, and they've got like five different types of dragon Pokemon that look different and do different things. And you can express your own, like a lot of Pokemon, I think, is people expressing their own like self through, if I want to be like, I've got only water Pokemon, or I've got this style of Pokemon, and it's what reflects me. And so like going back to the original 150, it's a little hard where it's like, cool, so I can choose between two different electric types. Yep. Besides Pikachu. So yep. If I don't want Pikachu, I can have a magnet or a ball.
Well,
got it.
Well, I will say Let's Go Eevee, Let's Go Pikachu did what it was supposed to do correctly, which was baby's first Pokemon. Like all those people that have been playing Pokemon Go, they weren't ready for Eevee training. They weren't ready for breeding. They weren't for, you know, making a sex slave out of Ditto. They weren't ready for that. But they were ready for throwing Pokeballs at the same 150 grass type they've already been catching in the app this whole time. And so it's, and I'm sure you got kids out there. If you want to get
with the wild Pokemon, I really found that disappointing.
And to some extent, I hope that it's just an option moving forward. Like I do like battling wild Pokemon, but I'm hoping capturing is similar. In that I don't like having to weaken and then try to fight him while he's weak. I don't know. I want a hybrid system or optional system for the mainstream Pokemon, but there's not been a Nintendo Direct talking about it yet, but we're supposed to get a mainline Switch entry this year that you'll play 5 years from now, so that'll be exciting. Oh, you will play that when it comes out.
No. I'll Pokemon games I'll buy. I'm at Target the day they come out.
Yeah. That's one
I'm
of the
at Target the day they come
Pokemon
out.
Pokemon games are one of the few things I still will pre-order. Even if it's bad, I'm put 100 hours into it, so...
Yeah.
But
I just hope that we get to see the, like, I really liked seeing the Pokemon on the overworld map. So it wasn't a random encounter, which made going through like caves so much better. Cause you could just walk away from the Zubats.
Amen.
And I don't have to be like every 5 seconds, Zubat, I hate you, Zubat.
So I hope that they, you know, take the things that people liked about this one and add it into the mainline one.
Yeah,
but keep some of those original systems that the veterans prefer,
and let them be options. It's okay. Turn it off. Turn it on. Let it, you know, like options are great. We should talk about Anthem because this weekend was the VIP, very important player invite for the demo. Not a
very
beta.
Fancy.
Yeah, not a demo.
How do I become a very important player, Boogie?
Yeah, you pre-order.
Oh,
you have to go ahead and buy that game before you know what it is. That way you get to try it out and see if you like it.
Okay. Or you can do what I do, which is pay $5 a month for EA Access on PC or Xbox, and then you can play it that way too. That was a way to get in. And there will be an open beta in February. I don't think either of you guys played in the beta, did you?
I watched a lot of footage.
And Professor won't for 7 years. So long story short... It is, I made a video about it today, so I'll recapture that a little bit. It is exactly what I thought it was going to be. It's a looter shooter. It borrows a little bit from Warframe. It borrows a little bit from Destiny. It borrows a little bit from The Division. It borrows a little bit from all of those games and then wraps it up in a BioWare bundle and just says, let's go. And the javelins are cool.
It really makes you feel like Iron Man.
And it does. It kind of made me feel like Iron Man flying around and shooting. Of course, Iron Man can fly for more than 22 seconds at a time. So that's, you know, one of the problems. But I don't know why your jets are failing every 30 seconds with overheating in that game. But they do. And then it was looter shoot. It was looty shooty. If you like to play Destiny and you like to shoot the same monsters over and over again to get glowy things off the ground that turn out to be loot at the end of the thing. So you can disenchant that loot to get scraps of stuff that you need to make loot you might actually use. This game is for you. The boss fights were fun. The one boss fight in the game.
Okay.
Fun. Bullet spongy, but fun. I really like the abilities, like all the abilities my javelin had. The javelin is what they call the mech suit. It felt fast and powerful and fast paced. The guns were really anemic. It didn't feel like I was doing anything, just making a bar go down a little bit. Like I didn't feel impact or anything. And they didn't make the bars go down near as much as my abilities did, especially my ultimate, obviously, but So I felt like I was relying more on my abilities than my gun, but maybe I just had a weak gun for my level. I don't know.
No, I think that's how the game is supposed to play. I think it's supposed to be, I'm going to use a lot of abilities at the bad guys, and then if I mess up my rotation, or if there's like everything's on cooldown, I need to shoot my gun for a few seconds.
Right. Yeah, it's definitely not as rotate, like when you say rotation, a lot of people are going to think World of Warcraft, where I'm going 1-3-5-3-3-2, 1-3-5-3-1-2-2. It's not necessarily that. You're just doing 1-2-3-4, and there's going to be a little bit of downtime in between them, but most abilities refresh within 30 to 60 seconds. Do it
between them.
Yeah,
is there a big difference between the different cyberspace wizards that fly through the air?
Yeah, so there's four different javelins, and they each have their own specialties. There's like an offensive one that does like ninja abilities, right? And then there's the one they give you in the demo, when you start the demo, and it's kind of balanced. And then there's like a very defensive one, is meant to be taunty and tanky and stuff. So there's like four different classes, right? And then you can specialize your classes based on the items that you've picked up. So you might choose for the balance class, you might choose the toxic darts, or you might choose the beam ability, or you might choose this grenade or the frost grenade, or you might choose this shield over that shield, and then you combine your guns with that to get a lot of customizations to build a loadout that you can't change once you're inside a mission. You're stuck with it throughout the mission, but you could have several different loadouts for each javelin, and there's a lot of variety in it. When the game works, it's fun. It doesn't work, but when it did, it was good. If you weren't staring at a loading screen for an hour, if you weren't loading all the time because you had to go in and out of little areas, if you weren't getting the internal server connection bug, if you weren't getting kicked out of your party or kicked out of your zone or thrown back to the entry screen, when those things weren't happening, and they always were, it was okay.
Okay. Was it playable when those things weren't happening in terms of like, you know, there's those two categories of bugs of I can't play the game, I'm stuck on a loading screen, it's broken or whatever. And then I'm in the game world, but I'm clipping into the floor. Things don't function the way that they're supposed to.
A lot of people reported rubber banding, and the rubber banding was a real issue for a lot of people. But that's still server side for the most part, right? Mm-hmm. My bullets went where my bullets were supposed to go. And monsters went where they were supposed to go. The AI was terrible. The AI just would stand there sometimes or focus somebody else when I was shooting them in the head. It didn't matter. Somebody told me it was because there was a taunt mechanic, and I don't know if that's why, but sometimes I would just shoot the same five monsters in the head until they died, and they would never turn to face me for some reason. Were you saying something there?
Yeah, well, that's what I wanted to talk about was Ellis was asking about the different abilities that the javelins have. They are quite different. Beyond just the ranger, like being able to pick, like, here's the direction I want my damage to go, the Colossus does have a taunt ability.
Okay, cool.
Uses it and pulls aggro on everything around. He also has like an AoE like health buff that he does. So he's like meant to be a tank. He has a big old shield that he can hold out in front of him and revive down javelins. So that if he's doing that, you and the person you're reviving don't get shot. Whereas if anyone else goes to revive that javelin, somebody might shoot at you and down you while you're doing that.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
So, like, all of them have a pretty clear role. I will say most of them are just kind of do a lot of damage over here in this spot with a few variations here and there.
Right.
Okay.
And it is highly customizable in that you get to, like, pick what abilities you have. Mm-hmm. Like different abilities will drop that have stats as well. So it's not just, well, these are the abilities my class has, and then I pick the stats for my gun. It all has ability modifiers.
So my overall I think maybe the overall consensus for all of us, but my overall feeling for it is, if it doesn't turn out to be, because almost all the bugs are server-side issues, right? The infinite loading screen, there was at least one bug that I saw during my playthrough where the cutscene just failed to function, and that wouldn't be server-side, that's client-side. So there's issues like that. You fixed the server problems, you have a slightly above average looty shooty game where you grind on the same monsters over and over and over again to get slightly better gear. And if that appeals to you and the servers work, you'll have a slightly above average game that will probably be ruined by microtransactions.
Actually, I want to talk about that for a second, because that was one of the other things that I wanted to bring up. The way that they have talked about this game, and specifically how they said they wanted it to work, is that you will buy the game and then all of the things that you will pay real money for are purely cosmetic, including all of the story DLC stuff that comes out later.
Right.
They said they don't want to lock any of that behind a paywall. The only thing that you will ever have to pay money for, and even then you don't have to pay the money for, is cosmetic stuff.
Right.
It will have its I hope they keep the word on that.
And when it, if they do stick to that, like in the demo, like shaders in Destiny 2, you had to like pay to open loot boxes to get shaders, right? You got every shade in the rainbow, a full-on active color wheel in the customization tier, so you want to set your colors and stuff like that. What it looks like you will pay for is like, I want a helmet that kind of looks like this, and I want legs that don't look like a chicken, maybe. I don't know, because they all look like chicken legs for some reason.
They none of them come out of a loot box. Whenever you go to buy something, mm-hmm. you pay money and you get the thing that you paid for.
Yeah,
and
okay, that's an improvement.
And you pay the premium currency, which I don't know, you might be able to grind the premium currency in some way within the game. It's unclear, but hopefully, like, I mean, Red Dead Redemption 2 allows you to sort of grind it, so maybe you would sort of grind it here too, hopefully.
I'm not 100% sure on that one, but I, you know, the game looks fine from what I've seen. It looks like it's a kind of game that I do like, and it looks like a fine version of that. And man, do I really want to support the give us $60 and then we'll just get a game and then that's it. I want to support that so much.
The demo told me that I will buy this. I might buy it 30 days after it comes out once the servers are stable, and that's what I would recommend to most people. Wait till the servers are stable before you buy. But it should be a fun experience. And the problem with that, this kind of game is the largest part of the player base will also be gone after 30 days because the casuals will come in, jump in, play, and leave. And then you'll just be left with the hardcore players. So if you're not a hardcore player, you need to play early, but then the servers won't be stable. So a lot of us non-hardcore people are just kind of shit out of luck, I guess. Professor O always wondered, as a person who spends so much money playing Magic the Gathering, how much would you say you spend on a brand new set of cards? When a set like the latest Ravnica block comes out, how much would you say you set on this last block? Non-business related, necessarily, right?
Okay, I was going to ask because, so the thing is that I have, it's a business now, so I have to spend the money. Personally, I don't buy a booster. I buy a booster box for every set to do the booster box game, but that's a business expense. I would not be doing that otherwise. What I do is I personally sign up for all six pre-releases, even if I can't attend them all. I've got a giant library of unused pre-release kits. And if you were over, if you guys were at my house right now and stuff, I might say, hey, do you guys want to like do a pre-release? And I'll just be like, I got some Almond Cat, I got some whatever, I got some Shadows over Innistrad, and I'll toss them out and we each open up a pre-release kit and stuff. So I always consider that a great investment is I just sign up for all six pre-releases at my LGS. And then maybe attend like two of them, four if I've got a babysitter. Beyond that, it's really just purchasing singles. And then if there's any, because again, I have to buy every product that comes out.
Of course.
So when the Commander comes out, I have to buy all five of them to test them, or four of them now. They've gone down to four. I have to buy all four of them to test them out. And I'm happy to have those cards. I've got a great Commander library, but I wouldn't personally be buying all four. I'd probably be picking one up a year sort of thing. I think you're asking this question to gauge just what am I spending versus you were talking about like 60
Right.
I spend more than $60 per set. I would definitely say I spend way more than $60.
Right. So you and I are used to spending about every 3 months from Magic. I will buy a case, and then it's a business expense.
I won't do that. I feel like that's a poor use of my money.
Oh, it's a huge, waste of my money.
I will spend what you waste on a case, Boogie, on actual good cards. Like I will buy cards I can play with in Modern or that soup up my Commander decks, as opposed to you just getting a bunch of jank. Well, but you do you, Boogie.
No, I buy the case number one at cost for my local gaming store because I have money invested in that store. Secondly, not only do I pay cost for it, but it's a tax write-off because I'm opening it all on stream. And number three,
tax write-off for a YouTuber,
right? And then number three, very important, it's a tax write-off because I'm opening them all on stream. I talked to my tax guy, okay? Damn it, he said I can write them off, okay? And
Dave,
I do.
The tax guy.
And then number three, I do get donations and subscriptions and stuff when I open them live on stream, so I generally make money from doing it. Would I do that in my private life? Nope. I would do exactly what you would do. I would play in every pre-release I could get my hands on. I would get as many pre-release kits as I could, and then I would buy and trade singles. And normally, I would buy one box to draft with my friends. and then
many singles. I just picked up a playset of the Lord of Atlantis Judge Foils, which just came out, which is gorgeous art. And it's the only Lord of Atlantis with fixed Oracle text printed on it. It's beautiful art and such. Oh, I'm so happy to get that. I spend so much money on singles because I'm addicted to building decks.
Well, now you're
one pack every new set so that every 24 sets I can do a twisted draft with different packs. And then I get 8 people together and we do that.
Oh, that's fun. That's great fun.
My torment pack is in Japanese, so that's going to be a challenge for whoever gets that one.
Oh, God. Why?
That's what the internet's for.
Yeah. But at the end of the day, my question is, what I was leading to, is knowing that Anthem has an infinite amount of money I could spend on cosmetics if I wanted to. But Star Wars Battlefront 2 from the same company, published by the same company, not made by the same company, wanted me to spend a fortune either to grind 1,000 hours, which you and I don't have time for. Nobody in this chat has that kind of time. Or we could spend money to get the cards we needed to unlock certain classes and unlock certain characters and unlock certain abilities in those characters, including higher level versions of those, which we could have either tried to grind for, but we needed the cards for. What do you think about modern gaming? Knowing that you're the kind of person who will spend a lot of money on your passion. What do you think about modern games and what you've heard about them through my channels and other people's channels?
Does Fallout New Vegas count as a modern game?
No.
I really liked that game.
It was good.
I played that game for the first time last year, and I loved it.
What?
So much.
That came out in like 2006.
I played it for the first time last year. I got it when I was sick, and I played it because everybody said since I liked Skyrim, I should do it. And I was like, I'm not going to like this because I don't usually like. You know, like zombies and stuff. Not that it was all zombies, but I don't usually like that aesthetic. And I was so addicted to it, like you wouldn't believe, and stuff that I went and got the other Fallout games and played them. But I loved it so much.
It came out in
like The Witcher 3. Last year.
You played The Witcher 3?
Wait, that you'll play.
I did not play not played The Witcher 3.
Okay, so
or The Witcher anything.
All right.
Just started 3.
So this game came out back in 2010, which is really close to about the time we had
2010 is modern.
The first piece of horse armor DLC. Roughly around there. So in 10 years, let's talk about how you feel about all the microtransactions that came out this year.
But like,
when you finally get caught up.
There were in Skyrim and Fallout New Vegas, like you spent money to get extra levels and maps and adventures.
Well, those are called expansions, and that is not what a DLC is.
Okay.
Here's what a DLC is.
I didn't like that so much. Like that was cool in Skyrim, like, and then it was like, oh, you get on a boat and you go to this other island and there's all these new quests, and I thought that was pretty cool. It's like, okay.
No,
10-20 bucks.
Here's what I'm talking about.
You're right. That was totally fun.
Have you ever played a Call of Duty game or one of those shooty games?
Nope.
You ever play like any game where you shot a bunch of monsters?
I don't like. So I'm very sorry to have to admit this, but I am of that hippy dippy generation of guns aren't toys. That's why I didn't do it. So I grew up. I wasn't allowed to have toy guns.
But you did. But you did use guns in New Vegas. Okay.
Yes, that was the first gun game I've really ever played.
Okay, that's good.
I tried to get the laser guns so they didn't look real.
So instead of spending a couple of bucks to get some new levels and some new places to explore and some new stories, imagine if in New Vegas it was $2 to change the reticle of your laser gun to red.
I would probably spend that, except I'd want it to be green.
Oh,
and I like what I really want. I kept looking in the game to get like a real like sci-fi looking laser, and too many of them looked like they were like what things would really look like. And I'm like, no. I want like what they have in Futurama or Star Trek or something.
Man, I want to go get my replica Fallout 4 laser to show you what he thinks looks like a real laser machine. Well, that is what modern gaming has come down to. The latest Call of Duty game will sell you a reticle. A red reticle. You can
change the reticle for
a dollar, and you can turn it into a smiley face for $2.
All right. I'm going to admit something here.
Mm-hmm.
This is absolutely true, and this is going to make everyone who is still watching this hate me more than they already do, which is probably quite a lot. But this is true. I love the Sim games, like Sim City, Sim Earth, Sim Ant, Sim The Sims.
They're great.
And I was playing The Sims, like I think The Sims 3, and there was an option to spend a couple bucks, and it would add a Prius as an available car to purchase for your Sim to purchase, and I did that. so that I could have a Prius in The Sims because I like the smell of my own farts.
That's going to wrap up this week's podcast starring Boogie, Jacob Ellis, and Cucky Cuckington over there from...
basically, that has caused people to not only unsubscribe from my channel, but to unsubscribe from yours as well, Boogie.
Thank you for bringing that to us. We really appreciate it. Our first guest is going to go so well.
Oh, guys. All right. Well, let's see. Professor, if I wanted to find your content online, and specifically, I meant to mention this personally right at the beginning, but you've got a podcast of your own now.
Yes, but It's on my YouTube channel because I don't know how to monetize like regular. It's on iTunes as well. It's called Dies to Removal, and it's all Magic the Gathering, myself and my co-host Pleasant Kenobi, which I believe is a Star Wars reference. I've never seen Star Wars, but I believe never seen any of the Star
Who
Wars.
Who is this man?
Yes. I hear they're really good.
That's not true.
I figure when my kid's 13, if he were 10 or whatever, what age do you have to be to watch Star Wars? Like the good ones, not the bad ones.
Episode 4, 5, and 6, you can watch them. And you can
4, 5, or 6. So when he's 6 and he wants to watch it, I will watch it with him. But I just never been interested. But anyway, I'm on YouTube, Tolarian Community College. That's the main hub to find me. If you want to listen to a podcast with myself and Pleasant Kenobi talk about all things Magic the Gathering, we're on iTunes and Spotify. It's called Dies to Removal.
It gets very confrontational, too, I've noticed. It's a good podcast, boy, but you guys are at each other's throats. I love it.
We are gentlemen who enjoy the spirit of debate and discussion and reasonable argument about this children's trading card game that we love. The main place to find me is Tolarian Community College on YouTube and any other social media crap. Yep.
And if you want to see reviews for board games, you want to see reviews for card games, you want to see reviews for just about every collectible thing in the world, or listen to a Magic the Gathering podcast. You ever thought about getting into Magic the Gathering? You want to learn how to get in? Tolarian Community College is the number one Magic the Gathering content creator in the world. Yeah, bigger than the actual official channel.
I'm very happy that I have more subscribers than Wizards of the Coast. That gives me no end of joy.
And so, of course, as usual, you can find Ellis and Jacob over there at big_breakfast on Twitch. They're streaming 5 nights a week, and I think you'd love what they're creating. And if you decide you want to follow me, I am YouTuber Boogie2988. My magic content is not as good as Cucky Cuckerton's. I'll give you credit for that. I've never owned a video game Prius for $5. Was it $5? Did you say?
I think it was it was like $2. It was like $2, I think.
You and are the problem.
The car options were terrible. And I really thought that my character should have had a Prius. So, you know.
I didn't know you were supposed to RP as your sim.
Yeah, that's so. I made a Sims thing when I was in grad school where I recreated my apartment and the Sim killed himself. And the Sim, like, he should have still been eating, but he just gave up on life and he just stopped eating and he stopped using the toilet and just went on the couch. And grad school was rough, you guys. Grad school was rough. Sim was like, fuck this shit. I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. Who gives a fuck about that shit? Hi, iTunes. Yeah. I will say I did play quite a bit of Sims growing up. Like I said, growing up, but it was in college and stuff. And then when the latest Sims came out, I did live stream it. But then people began to worry about me quite a bit because I played an angry clown who bought a ramshackle nightmare cottage that he then just like destroyed. Trash everywhere. He would invite neighbors over for parties and then wall them in and watch them suffocate and starve to death and dying in the puddles of their own urine. And people are like, I don't think I want to watch you do anything ever again. And that was when they first got a taste about what an actual sociopath I really am.
And then I recreate the TARDIS interiors.
What is wrong with you?
You're so wholesome.
No, that's way better. No. I'm with the professor here. This is way better.
I drove my Prius to my TARDIS.
I drove my Prius to my job every day and did a good job at sim work and used that money to invest in a house.
God.
That looked like the TARDIS.
Took a while to get off the rails.
The TARDIS on the inside.
Gotta be, Jacob, so as usual, we do wrap this up with a weird question, Professor. And do we have a weird question prepared? Yes. Is it sent in by a fan? Do you have one prepared, Jacob, by chance?
I have two.
Okay.
I have a pretty weird one, and then I have a Magic the Gathering related one. And I wanted to do both.
Okay.
Let's do the weird one first. All right.
Yeah.
Getting ready. How many grains of rice can you fit in your belly button? Now, before everyone answers, I know how many grains of rice I can fit in my belly button.
Have you done this?
And I'm not going to tell you why I know this, but it is 4.
Long grain or like jasmine rice or boten rice? What kind of rice are we talking
about? The 97 cents a pound rice that you get off the bottom shelf of a Walmart.
Okay.
Look,
cooked,
dude.
Or uncooked?
Yeah, cooked or uncooked. That's
uncooked.
Important.
Uncooked.
Uncooked rice. All right.
Okay.
If you cook it, it gets all mushy. You can get more in there. That's cheating.
I was once 600 pounds, and now I have a bunch of loose skin down there. So I would like to find out, but I'm going to Sam's Club or Costco to get enough rice to find out, okay? Because I can fit enough in there to feed a family of 6, dude. It's bad. I literally am storing a banana in my belly button right now for snack time, okay? That's how bad it is.
So, I'm going to say 6. I got a deep belly button.
Get deep belly button.
Yeah, there's a lot of space in there.
Weird.
I can fit almost the whole digit of my index finger.
I can fit 6 grains of rice in the gap between my 2 front teeth. What the hell? Look at that. Professor?
I'm going to say 2 because even if I could fit more, I would stop after 2.
That's probably a good plan.
This is the kind of man that he is. Everyone else fingered our belly buttons a little bit, but he just didn't.
Oh, yeah. I was like, hmm.
Yeah. Ellis is just digging in there, boy. He wanted to know.
Reasonable, level-headed, and we're over here putting rice in our belly buttons. That was from Seth. Thank you so much, Seth. All right. Let's do this magic-related question. So this is a Jacob original. I came up with this. Last June... Wizards printed the Jace signature spell book. I don't know if you remember that. They had like blue multiple ass counter spell brainstorm stuff like that. What's your signature spell? What's in your signature spell book? So I'll go first. Mine is Bloodbraid Elf. You can name a couple. That's fine. Mine's just Bloodbraid Elf several
times. Just Bloodbraid, not even whatever Bloodbraid Elf cascades into.
No, just Bloodbraid Elf several times.
Okay.
Oh, you got some Ellis?
Yeah, Trinket Mage, Death Cloud, and Light from the Loam.
Says a lot about you as a human being.
Him to Turok, Mind Twist, Stupor, Mind Rot, and the Rack.
Those get like gradually less.
That's
because
they stopped printing the obscene ones, and I had to come up with some to fill the deck.
Do you remember for the longest time you had Mind Twist in your cube, and
yes.
I kept telling you, "Hey, this card is not fun," and you're like, "No, it's fine.
It's
totally
fun
fine.
To me."
And then one time I mind twisted you for 5 on turn 1 and you got upset.
Yeah, I'm like, this is not fun. But it was fun when I cast it. Look, my very first tournament, Professor, I don't know if I've ever told you the story. My very first tournament, very first actual Magic the Gathering tournament, Mind Twist was not on the banned or restricted list for the first tournament.
Pretty cool.
So I walked in with 4 Dark Rituals, 4 Mana Vaults, and 4 Mind Twists. I had to borrow a Mind Twist from a friend to get 4. And then the rest of the deck was Sarah Angels and Singer Vampires, because sometimes I would Dark Ritual a Singer Vampire out and just wreck you. And then some Swords to Plowshares and some Tears so I could kill everything you did. And if you managed to keep it in your hand to put it in the play field and managed to get enough land, then I would just kill it and then I would just murder you with a White Knight or a Sarah Angel or a Singer Vampire or a Black Knight. And I just dominated that tournament. But 4 Mind Twists, you could turn 1 Dark Ritual, Mana Vault, Mind Twist your entire hand away. I don't have anything either. Let's just top deck. Let's see what happens, right?
But. Professor, you have a signature spell?
Pyroblast. 1 red mana, counter target blue spell, or destroy target blue permanent. It's nothing feels better as a red player than countering a player's spell.
I'm
counter that. You're on mono red. I know.
Yeah. I'm right there with you with the red mage energy.
It's
yep.
Fantastic.
Absolutely.
And it's, what is it? 8 copies of Hydroblast or Pyroblast.
Yeah, well, there's only 4 legal in Pauper. Blue Elemental Blast and Red Elemental Blast are not technically Pauper legal, even though they're commons because they haven't been printed at common on Magic Online. And so it's just Pyroblast and Hydroblast.
Oh, so I know you're so really weird into Pauper. And I was looking online because I figured maybe we would talk about some Pauper on the podcast. And I was like, oh, I got to, brush up. I haven't checked out that format in a while. Every video I found was yours.
There's actually a lot of content creators. We're having our very first Pauper PTQ at GP Los Angeles in
That's
a month.
Right.
there if anyone attends GPs.
Just in time for Peregrine Drake in the format.
Yep, yep. That's good. It's a great format. Some of the best spells in Magic the Gathering are common. Counterspell, common. Lightning Bolt, common. Delver of Secrets, common. Gary, Merchant of Asphodel, common. We got some good stuff.
And your video on the mill advisors from Ravnica, I loved that. It was quite the troll deck. I give you credit for that one.
Troll decks are fun.
Yeah. So if you ever wanted to get into Magic on a budget and you don't mind spending $10 on a common that's been out of print for 14 years, you can play Pauper. but there is a lot of decks that you can put together for like $20.
Yep.
Pauper's a great way to just build some decks for that format and keep them together forever. And Wizards of the Coast, if you're listening to this, and I know you were not.
They are not.
If you were, please support Pauper. But I know that sometimes you get to talk to those folks over there, Brian, so I know you'll be hyping up Pauper as loud and hard as you can, right?
Yep, that's pretty much my mission in life.
Yep. And for those of you who want to, check out mtgarena.com. If you ever wanted to learn to play this wonderful game that we've been spending the last 90 minutes regaling you with stories of, it's a great way to learn and a great way to play. Any closing statements this week, Jacob Ellis?
We will play MTG Arena with you if you want to hop in the Big Breakfast Discord. We have a channel devoted to that, and we love playing with viewers.
Professor, anything we missed? You got a closing statement, closing top, and anything we missed?
We had a lot of fun here today on the Big Stack podcast, but at the end of the day, whether it's Hearthstone or Anthem or some kind of Fallout game from apparently not the modern era, which does not make sense to me, whatever it is you love to play in video games or paper gaming and board gaming and tabletop, that's really what it's about. Have fun, and that's the right game. The game that you enjoy to play.
He is so wholesome. This is why I'm proud to call this man a friend. I'm so glad that you were our first guest and kind of a role model, honestly. To be honest with you, I wish I could be that wholesome.
Look up to the professor.
Right.
Thank you so much for being here.
Yeah, we're so glad to have you.
Had a great time talking to you.
Real honor to be here.
Guys, I hope that you're listening to this on iTunes. If you are, do us a favor and give it a rate. If you listen to us on Spotify, we appreciate it. If you're listening to it on the YouTube channel, hit subscribe on that channel. Drop a like. Check out the links in the description box below here on YouTube. You can check out Tolarian Community College on YouTube. Check out his Patreon. You can check out our Patreon at patreon.com/thebigstackpodcast. And you can find us now on YouTube at youtube.com/thebigstackpodcast. Links to everybody that was on this in the description box below. Guys, we appreciate you listening. Thanks for watching. We love you very much.
Goodbye.
We'll speak with you again very soon. Bye.
Goodbye.